If you could make your way back, I do have a history of calling names out individually, so I'm looking at you, give you a little bit of time. Morgan, watching you. Fantastic. Well, here at our National Conservative Student Conference, we are excited for each day this week to have partnered with a different organization as our sponsor of the day. And today we are excited and proud to have one of our allies in the fight for freedom, the Alliance Defending Freedom. So I'm going to welcome to the stage Casey Maddox to explain a little bit about what ADF offers U.S. students. He is the Senior Counsel and Director of the Center for Academic Freedom at ADF. So please join me in welcoming to the stage after we play this awesome video, Casey Maddox.
Your right to share what you believe matters. Your opinions, your ideas, your free speech. Hours spent in debate, in dialogue, your life, your campus, even your world, all of it shaped and changed by what you believe. But what you believe might not be welcome, could be against the rules, and get you in trouble. It did for her and him, them. They wanted to change things with a club, a viewpoint, an event, but they were told no, not here, not welcome. Colleges everywhere making policies that censor the rights of every student and sometimes targeting certain views. Some are obvious, some not so much. But it doesn't have to be this way. We help them change their campus, and we can help you change yours. We're a legal organization defending free speech on your college campus. Take a stand, be a voice. Because your opinions, your ideas, your speech could change things. For students today, for students tomorrow. Because your rights, your freedoms matter.
Hello, YAF. So I'm Casey Maddox, and the short version of my bio is that I sue universities. I'm the director of ADF's Center for Academic Freedom, and over the past decade or so, we've had about 400 different victories for student free speech rights across the country, many of them for YAF chapters as well. We have about a 90% litigation success rate. So the first lesson I want you to take from this morning is that if you will stand up to the anti-free speech policies on your campus, you can win. I don't need to convince you that your free speech rights are being violated. YAF is at the center of many of the biggest free speech battles happening on our campuses right now. YAF is, as I would say, freedom woke, right? But in the next couple of minutes, I just want to tell you why this fight matters so much for us. It matters because the people in this room are the voice of freedom on your campuses. You're a minority view that other people need to hear. Recent polls have actually shown that close to a half of millennials say that they support both socialism and hate speech rules. You're supposed to boo at this. That's bad news. Yeah. The good news is they have no idea what either of those things mean. They just know they support them. But that's exactly why your voice is so important, because you are freedom's ambassadors on your campus. You're the people there to tell them you don't want to support these things, these are bad ideas. And that's why people need to hear what you have to say. Without you, many of your fellow students would breeze right through college, head right into a career without anyone ever, without ever hearing any reasoned explanation from anyone about why big government is not in fact here to help them. So you're a critical voice on your campus, but it also matters because what happens on your campus is not going to stay on your campus. I'm encouraged when I look at this room full of people about our future. But the reality is that your fellow students in your sociology class are also the ones that you have in your mind right now that sort of terrify you, what they believe. Those people are also going to be our future legislators and judges and teachers and voters. And many of them are going to try to go come back here to Washington, D.C. and represent you. So maybe things are okay for you on your campus. Maybe you're finding that your free speech rights, while the policies are bad, you're actually able to make it through and you're getting your government-approved permit to speak on your campus at the prescribed time in the prescribed place. But the reality is that when these universities are creating these speech codes that tell you what you can say and speech zones that tell you where you can say it, rules telling you who you have to get permission from before you can do any of that, requiring you to pay student activity fees to fund other people's speech and then taking that money and skewing the debate against you on your campus, requiring you to pay security fees for your speakers because they're controversial when you're listening to the speakers come from the other side that are far more controversial than anything you're trying to do. When you see those kinds of policies, basically what it communicates to all of those not freedom woke students that you're dealing with is that freedom is too dangerous to permit. There's a reason why government imposes those kinds of rules, and it must be because freedom is dangerous. That their rights come from the vice president of student affairs, or whoever's name is on the inside cover of the student handbook, right? Whoever signed that thing, that's where their rights came from. And that if you don't like what someone has to say, or even what they believe, that the answer is to go to the government and ask the government to do something about it. That's a dangerous prospect for our future. But when you think about those folks, it can be a little frightening, right? The people who are going to graduate from your university alongside you. But think of the opportunity. This means you have the chance to convince the next Elizabeth Warren that freedom is actually a good thing before she tries to come here and destroy all of our lives, okay? You have that opportunity on your campus. In my opinion, the most effective thing that you can do to advance freedom in our nation and for our future is to deregulate your campus, okay? Eliminate these policies. Work to make your campus a place where the First Amendment is both respected and exercised freely, where people disagree and yet snowflakes somehow go unharmed, right? Where the answer is more debate, not more government. Make your campus the kind of place where you want our country to be. You can see us at the table outside. We'd be happy to talk with you about how we can partner with you to try to make that happen. And so God bless YAF. Thank you for all you do. Look forward to working with you in the future.
Thank you, Casey. All right, good morning, everyone. I'm so excited to introduce to you Mr. Larry O'Connor. Mr. O'Connor is a popular and respected talk radio show host in Washington, D.C. on WMAL. He serves as the contributing editor of Mediaite.com and is a frequent guest on major news networks such as Fox, ABC, and PBS. Mr. O'Connor has been a force in creating internet news and social media websites. A former editor-in-chief of Breitbart TV, he was instrumental in the development of Breitbart News Network. Mr. O'Connor also created one of the first live daily internet radio podcasts, attracting a large and loyal audience. The success led him to his own radio show, bringing an entertaining conservative voice to the airwaves. He currently lives in Maryland with his wife. Please welcome Larry O'Connor.
Good morning. Good morning. Whoa, hi. There's a lot of you. Good morning. Good morning. Good to have you. I am so lucky that I'm part of the only early morning session that you guys have had all week. And it's the last day. And I know that you all have been going to bed really early. Why is that funny? Are you enjoying Washington? Yeah, I know. I'm a conservative Republican, but I will admit it. It's a pretty good town, isn't it? It really is. I'm supposed to hate it, right? We're supposed to hate Washington. But we're supposed to hate the people who work here and the people who love being here to do that work, because that work messes up the rest of us around the country, right? But as a town, it's actually just like your town. There's great restaurants. I'm Chick-fil-A. And there's really great things to do at night. There's movies, there's theater, there's all that stuff. The difference is when you're out at Chick-fil-A or if you're out at the theater and you're seeing Hamilton, which hasn't come here yet. Have you seen Hamilton? Oh, you one percenter. There was one. You're sitting next to a politician. Or even more insidious, you're sitting next to somebody who makes a whole lot of money talking to politicians. And trying to convince them to screw up your town when they get back home. And that's weird. I mean, every city has a business, right? Seattle, you know, you're probably either working for Starbucks or you're working for Microsoft, right? If you're in the Bay Area up in California, you're working for Google or Apple or something like that, right? If you're in Southern California, you're working for Hollywood. And that's the there's a company town, right? Well, we are a company town, and the company is government. And it's gotten big. And I moved here about 5 years ago when everyone else in the country was still feeling it from the recession, and they weren't feeling it here. It's been really weird to do talk radio here and try to talk about what's happening where you guys live because people here don't get it. The economy isn't great. There's a place called Tyson's Corner, Virginia. It's right where the Beltway, which is the expressway that goes around D.C., it meets the road that takes you to Dulles Airport, right? It's right there, Tyson's Corner. You look at a picture of Tyson's Corner from 25 years ago, and it looks like a farm. And now there's always a crane building a giant tower. So I know that people always talk about, oh, Washington, they're out of touch, they don't get it. Well, I talk every day to listeners in this town, people who are commuting back and forth. The people who are commuting, who live half an hour out, they get it. That's all you have to do is drive half an hour out of this town, and they know how different America is from Washington, D.C. So why do I make this point? Because I'm guessing you're all here and you're part of this great organization and you're here listening to all these great speakers all week because you'd like to change the world, or at the very least change this country, right? That's part of what you'd like to do. Well, you're in the wrong town. The fact of the matter is, if you really want to change this country, if you really want to change what happens in your town, if you really want to change what happens in your neighborhood and at your school or at your parents' work and your parents' job, you want to go to Hollywood. You want to go to New York. You want to change the culture. And I didn't come up with this myself. I learned this from a guy named Andrew Breitbart. Now, does anyone here know Andrew Breitbart? Okay. Now, are you cheering the man or are you cheering the website that has his name? Do you know the man? Andrew Breitbart died 5 years ago. When I first met Andrew Breitbart, I wasn't working in journalism. I wasn't a talk radio host. I wasn't a blogger. I was working on Broadway. I wasn't on stage. I was working in management and production for Broadway musicals. Hamilton. We had a thing called Les Mis. Now that's a musical. Right? All right. And I do like Hamilton, I'm teasing. But I worked in New York for 5 years because when I was your age, that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to work on Broadway. I loved Broadway theater. I loved that. And so I went there. I followed my dream. I got a job and very quickly realized, wow, everyone here is liberal. Really liberal. I mean, you think Hollywood is liberal. Take a look at the Tony Awards every year. All right? Kinky Boots won, okay? The Tony Award. So then I got transferred back to Los Angeles, where I'd grown up. I'd grown up in Orange County, California. Anyone? Right? Ronald Reagan called Orange County, California, a place where good Republicans go to die. In the 1984 re-election campaign, Ronald Reagan won, I believe, 92% of the vote in Orange County, California. It's different now, isn't it? Yeah, it is. Loretta Sanchez. But I went back to Southern California and I managed the Schubert Theater in Los Angeles. The company I worked for in New York was the Schubert Organization. They owned 17 Broadway theaters. And I went back to Los Angeles and loved my job, loved the people I worked with, loved doing what I was doing. We did Sunset Boulevard, the American premiere with Glenn Close the first time around. We did Rent. Yeah, I like those kids too. We did Ragtime. We did Cats, I believe, 4 times. We had all these shows in this really big theater. It was, oh, and Beauty and the Beast. Anyone? Beauty and the Beast? Yeah, it was awesome. Working with Disney, families coming to the theater, all these new generation of kids coming to see the theater. It was fantastic. But again, everyone I worked with. Now, I had some friends who knew that I was right of center. And we would debate politics because that's the stuff of life, and we would talk about those things. And I learned at that time to be able to debate those things and discuss those things in a way that I didn't make people think that I was a racist, xenophobic, homophobic asshole. For the most part. Some of them still think that, but most of them didn't. And that's a skill, and it's something that you need to learn, because I think that that's allowed me to do what I do now in Washington, D.C., because you can't grow a right-leaning radio program in Washington on the Mark Levin Rush Limbaugh station during drive time when everyone's going to and from work if you can't figure out how to talk about these things and be acceptable to those who might disagree with you. People would call me up when I did the morning show on WMAL, and they would often say, you should have heard how Mark Levin talked about this yesterday. I mean, he ripped them anew. You know, you should, I can't believe it. And I said, dude, no one wants to wake up to Mark Levin. Mrs. Levin doesn't want to wake up to Mark Levin, all right? In terms of the conversation. I don't know anything. Mark wouldn't mind me saying that, I promise. There's a way to talk about things, which leads me to Andrew Breitbart. So I'm working in the theater. I'm working with all these actors, makeup people, wardrobe people, all of them. The only people that I would find that agreed with me on certain aspects of politics, can you guess which part of the theater? Think about musical theater. Think about all of the various, you know, you've got your stagehands, you got this, da, da, da. Who do you think? There were two categories of employee. Not hairdressers. Close. Some of the stagehands. Only some of them, though. It depended. Some of the stagehands, yes. However, their union forced them to vote a certain way. No, sadly. Some of the tech, but musicians. But think about it. And these are not musicians like, you know, rock star musicians, right? These are musicians who studied when they were kids, learned their instrument, went to school, probably marched in the marching band, and now they only get, marching band? Yeah? And now they only get work and they only get a job if they continue to work hard, continue to practice, and they excel, and they are superior to their competitors, to the people, to their peers, right? And their excellence is rewarded. Conservative values, right? And even though they're in the arts, when you play in a pit orchestra with 25 other musicians, your job is to not freely express what it really means to be a transgendered individual in this country. Your job is to play the notes on the page and make sure that you're in line with your other musicians and you're following your leader. Not necessarily the same artistic outlet as you'll see in the theater and other areas, like hairdressers. So they ended up being allies to mine. But I very much felt isolated. Then I was listening to talk radio. I was a huge talk radio junkie, news politics junkie. And I heard the Dennis Miller show. You guys know Dennis Miller, right? An amazing man, I came to learn later. And he was interviewing a guy named Andrew Breitbart. And I had heard this name before, because there was this name on a website called Breitbart.com. Now, just to contextualize this is 2008, December. Barack Obama has just won the election. It's the final month of President George W. Bush's 8 years in office. There was no Breitbart News Network as we know it right now. There was a site called Breitbart.com that would aggregate news stories from the Associated Press and Reuters and other major news feeds. And you would really only go to this site because you clicked on a link from the Drudge Report. Drudge Report? Right. So the Drudge Report started in the mid-90s, and it jumped to fame because it was the one that broke the stories about Monica Lewinsky and Bill Clinton. Matt Drudge didn't do the reporting. Matt Drudge was able to get those stories from the reporters who actually did the reporting, but their publishers wouldn't publish the story. Did you know that? The original Monica Lewinsky story would never made it to the light of day if the publishers of Newsweek had their way. Why? That's an amazing story. Can you imagine if that story happened today in this administration? Can you think of any television producer or network boss or publisher of a website that would say, well, we can't do that, right? But the reporter leaked that story to Matt Drudge, and he published it, and history happened. Well, little did I know that Matt Drudge's assistant editor, person who ran the Drudge Report back in those days, it was like, my God, this is amazing. And you would refresh the page every 10 minutes because you wanted to see the next story. And it seemed like it was being updated almost 24 hours. Well, it kind of was, because Matt Drudge's assistant was a guy named Andrew Breitbart. And in the middle of the night, if he found a story, he would put it up. When I was working for him once, he would call me at 2 in the morning and say, hey, this has got to be up on the site. And I'm like, Andrew, you're the only one awake right now. And he hadn't been awake. True story. He had woken up to go to the bathroom, grabbed his BlackBerry while he was doing his business, he started searching and saw a story and decided, oh, Larry should put this up on the site, and he called me. But he wanted to be first. And anyway, back to the Dennis Miller Show. I'm listening to this interview with this guy named Andrew Breitbart, and in December he says, you know what, Andrew, by the way, he left the Drudge Report for a while and helped a woman named Arianna Huffington create a new site called Huffington Post. Did you know that? Andrew Breitbart, crazy right-wing, insane maniac, was one of the first people in the rooms with Arianna Huffington making Huffington Post. Doesn't make sense, right? Well, it does if you recognize that the actual idea at the time for Huffington Post was to be an open arena for all ideas coming from a place outside of Washington, D.C. Yeah. And Andrew was on board with that. You know, Arianna Huffington used to be a conservative pundit and commentator, right? That's what she used to do. One of the biggest champions of Newt Gingrich in this town. One of the chief critics against Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton. But that's a whole other story. So Andrew Breitbart is on with Dennis Miller, and he says, you know what, I had my experience with Huffington Post, didn't go the way we wanted it to go. I've been working with Matt Drudge. Conservatives, especially those in the entertainment business, they need an outlet. They need a place where they can go and have their voices heard. I know that there are conservatives, people right of center, who work in the entertainment business, and they're dying to be heard. I'm going to give them a forum. Next month, right before the Obama administration begins, I'm launching a website called Big Hollywood. I felt like he was talking to me. In fact, I literally thought he was talking to me. I was listening to this on a podcast, and I was diapering my fourth child, who had just been born. And Dennis Miller said, hey, Andrew, what are you doing right now, by the way? I always imagine, because you're doing the Drudge Report thing, I figure that, you know, you got seven computer screens going on at once, and you're doing this, and you're doing that. What are you doing? And he started chuckling, and he said, well, actually, I'm hands-free right now because I'm changing my fourth child's diaper. And I came to learn that Andrew Breitbart was my age and had four children. Boy, girl, boy, boy. Mine are girl, girl, boy, boy. And all the same age. Bizarre, right? But I do feel like God sometimes taps you on the shoulder. And so I immediately sent an email to the email at Breitbart.com and said, hey, I know you're going for TV and Hollywood people, but I work in the theater business. I'm conservative. I've got stories to tell. Within 30 seconds, call me with the phone number. And this is just to the info@Breitbart.com email address. But it was him. He was working out of his basement. He mortgaged his home twice to pay for Big Hollywood, Big Government, Big Journalism, and Big Peace, the four websites, and Breitbart TV, the five websites that ended up being merged into Breitbart.com, which is now the Breitbart News Network that you know. I wrote for him for a year under an assumed name. It was called Stage Right. Get it? Right. One of my proudest moments. And 6 months into it, instead of writing about the theater, I ended up writing about the media. I started writing about journalism. I started writing about how the media was reacting to the Acorn story from James O'Keefe, those hidden videos that broke on Big Government. I remember the day that launched, I sent Andrew a text and said, you're an American hero with these videos. This is incredible. You're changing the world. Little did I know. A year into it, he said, I want to hire you. I want you to write for me, and I want you to run one of my websites, but you can't be anonymous anymore. See, I wasn't getting paid for that year. I was just doing it because this was my outlet, and I was still working with producers and directors and labor unions, representing them, doing work, getting paid to help put shows on the stage or raise money for shows or manage shows. Last show I ever did. I'm not joking. Think of this. Ten Commandments, the musical. It gets better. Val Kilmer is Moses. Look it up. It's actually, the music isn't bad. In fact, Joshua, it's very biblical, this story, until you see what the slave girls were wearing. Joshua was played by Adam Lambert, pre-American Idol. I know. So I had been working on all of those things, and I was making money, and I had four kids, and I was married, and I had a mortgage, and I was doing all those things, and here's this crazy-haired nutbag who's created these four websites saying to me, I want to hire you, but you can't be anonymous anymore. And I said, well, that means I can't do what I do anymore. I mean, can you imagine if I were negotiating with a labor union in the theater business on behalf of a producer who's hired me, and I've got a paper trail on the internet railing against liberals and Democrats and espousing conservative values and also telling some secrets about what I'd experienced in the theater business under an assumed name? That would not happen. And so I made a choice. And I ended up making half of the money that I was making in theater, but I believed in this man. I followed this man. I believed that he was going to make a difference. I didn't realize that 8 years later, the website that bore his name would be instrumental in electing President Donald Trump, of all people, to the White House, but that's sort of what ended up happening. Now, a lot of people ask me, if Andrew were still alive, and by the way, he died incredibly tragically on March 1st, 2012, in the midst, his funeral was on the day of the Super Tuesday election, a day that he would have loved, when Rick Santorum won many states running against Mitt Romney and Newt Gingrich. His funeral was on that day. He died about four days before, I think, or 3 days before, on March 1st. It was 2 days before his dream was about to come true, to have all of those sites merged into one. I'm told by the doctors that he died before he actually hit the sidewalk out in front of a restaurant in Westwood, California. And I'm also told that it was inevitable. It was congenital. Andrew was adopted. He never knew his birth father or birth mother and never knew what kind of health record that they had. And we were told that he was a ticking time bomb. We were told that his heart was too big. And anyone who knew him would confirm that. I met Matt Drudge at the funeral. Matt Drudge is a very elusive person. No one's ever seen him for years. People imagine he's like Howard Hughes with fingernails like this, sitting in the corner of a condo in Miami, still clicking on his keyboard. And it's all true except for the fingernails. He does do some media appearances, rarely. I think his last interview was with Alex Jones, of all people, and you can find that. But he was at the funeral, and I got to meet him. We had traded emails. We still trade emails now and again. Mostly by trading emails, I mean I send him something, and sometimes it shows up on his site, and sometimes it doesn't, but that's good enough. And we were all going to a good old-fashioned Irish wake. Even though Andrew was raised Jewish, we did find out that if you look at him, you can tell he was Irish. We were going to have a real good Irish wake. Greg Gutfeld was going to be the key speaker. We were all going to get really, 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 really so effing drunk that night. And I asked Matt if he was going to join us at the wake, and he said, no. It's Super Tuesday. So when you get into media and you get into journalism, that's kind of the life you're choosing. Matt Drudge's friend, the guy who created the website with him, just died. I mean, he did get on a plane. He did fly from Miami to LA for the funeral. He made an appearance, which he never does, but that was it. I've got work to do. I gotta update the website. So, Andrew Breitbart built that website, built what you know today as Breitbart News Network, and it's being run by a young man named Alex Marlowe. Have you heard that name? Have you seen him at all? He was just on Bill Maher about a month ago, which is a show that Andrew used to go on all the time. Alex Marlowe was a Republican, in fact, I think the president of the Young Republicans at the University of California, Berkeley. And Andrew Breitbart was invited to be a guest speaker on that campus, and there were no bonfires. And he went and he spoke and he inspired Alex Marlowe. And Alex Marlowe came up to him afterwards and said, I want to work for you. He was a senior. He was about to graduate. I don't have a job. I don't have anything to do. I want to work for you. And Andrea said, well, I mean, I could use somebody to help me around the house because my wife is going nuts because I got a lot of stuff I got to do and I'm not getting to it because I'm working on the website and I'm going to be launching this new big Hollywood thing if you want. His first day on the job in Andrew's home was to help him move a sofa. But Alex was the first person that Andrew Breitbart ever hired. When I joined as editor-in-chief of Breitbart TV, which was the video aggregating website, which is a really new thing back then, Alex was the associate editor of all the sites. And now Breitbart News Network that you know today is run by Alex Marlowe. He's the editor-in-chief, and he hosts their morning show on SiriusXM every morning. Because he also was committed to this. He also understood that things can happen when you're passionate. Things can happen when you're associated with an enigmatic but powerful and creative leader like Andrew Breitbart. I tell you this story because one of the most important things that Andrew Breitbart said in that meeting with Alex Marlowe at UC Berkeley when he was speaking to a group smaller than this, but of people of the same age, was what I started with. If you want to change our country, if you want to change our world, if you want to change what happens in your neighborhood and your town, what happens in your house is much more important than what happens in the White House. Every 4 years, for some reason, our country goes insane obsessing about who will sit in the Oval Office. I mean, we already have a declared candidate for 2020. A congressman from Maryland just announced it last week. I don't think our founders ever expected that or wanted that, right? I mean, the whole idea of how our Constitution was set up was that we had direct representatives who would focus on our needs locally. Yes, we wanted a chief executive. Yes, we wanted a commander-in-chief. Yes, we wanted someone to act as head of state when talking to foreign leaders, assuming that those conversations wouldn't be leaked. But we shouldn't care so much about who's sitting in the Oval Office. We should be worrying about who's sitting in our family room and what they're watching on television. How many of you have heard your parents scream and complain and bitch and moan about liberals in Hollywood? How many of you complain about it? How many of you watch Saturday Night Live and say, okay, that's funny, but come on, you can't come up with one joke about Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton or Nancy Pelosi, right? Okay, addendum question. How many of you went to your parents and said, Mom, Dad, I really want to act. I really want to write. I really want to direct. I really want to be in the entertainment business. I really want to... And they said, no way. You've got to be responsible. You've got to be a lawyer. You've got to go to Wall Street. You've got to get a business degree. You've got to get... Right? And listen, there's nothing wrong with those degrees. But they have no right to complain. Here's what I've learned by working in both of these worlds. All of those people who are working in Hollywood right now, all of those people in the writer's room at Saturday Night Live, all of those people who are creating fantastic original content for Hulu and for Netflix, who are making all of that stuff that's pissing the hell out of you and your parents and everyone else in those giant red swaths across our country, all of them, for the most part, had parents who said, you bet, follow your dream. You bet. If this is what excites you, if this is what your passion is, if this is what you want to do, go for it. Because their parents were fine going to cocktail parties and saying, well, yes, my child is an intern at NBC right now. Conservative parents, sadly, like to go to those cocktail parties and say, well, yes, my child is an intern at We Fuck 'Em and You Lose Law Firm. So, I was fortunate enough to have a parent that either was thrilled to not have to pay for college after paying for my three older brothers, when I said, you know what, I want to take a year off after high school and I just want to go to New York. I've got an opportunity to be an intern with a stage manager and I'd like to do that just because I love Broadway. I'm going to get this out of my system for 1 year and then I'm going to come back and I'm going to go to college. And my dad was like, great, I'm fine with that. How much do you need? And I said, I want to make it on my own. And I did. And that 1 year turned into 5 years in New York. And then that turned into 12 years in Los Angeles. At the age of 24, I was the general manager of the largest theater my company owned, 2,200 seats, in Century City, California. I don't say that to brag, although it's pretty awesome. I say that to explain to you that this is really a great country, and there really are great opportunities, and you shouldn't expect the moment you get out of college, I know you owe a lot of money, but you shouldn't expect to make 100 grand immediately. And if you humble yourselves a little bit and actually do follow what you want to do and follow your passion, well, you could, in fact, make a big difference and eventually make a nice living. But most importantly, you'll actually be happy with yourself. You'll actually feel accomplished that you've been able to get to a place where you can listen to a person on the radio, get inspired by what they say, and say, you know what? If I could do this, I can do that. I don't have to stay in this lane. I don't necessarily have to do everything that has been prescribed for me from beginning to end since I was born. Because, see, when you guys were born, your parents started putting money into a tax-free account for your tuition. So that's why when you said, I really want to write, I really want to be an actor, I really want to dance, I can understand them not wanting you to dance. They said, hell no, we've been saving for your college education and you're gonna go and get a business degree. I'm not gonna waste my money on a performing arts degree. I'm not gonna waste my money on a creative writing degree. The parents can't see this, can they? You know I'm right. So, now it may be too late, and you may, who here has a degree in the arts? All right, well done. You don't need that. I didn't have it either. And I wasn't on stage, I didn't perform, which is ironic because that's kind of what I do right now on the radio. No, I went and I got a job as, this is so weird and I'm gonna make myself feel so old, I was a mail runner. And no, it's not some gay thing. It was Broadway. Email hadn't been born yet. God, I can't believe I'm saying this. And people used to type memos to each other and fold them and put them into a little manila envelope. Please tell me there's someone in this room that knows this. And thank you, camera person. And it was called an inter-office memorandum. And they would write that, and these envelopes had like 20 different empty lines on them. And you would cross out the name, your name, because you had it on your desk because someone just sent you a memo. You would cross out your name and you would write the name in the department of the person that you wanted to deliver this inner office memorandum to, and you'd put it in an outbox. And every hour or so, there was a little guy who would walk around the office and grab those envelopes and put them in a bag and then deliver them to the person who's supposed to get them. I swear to God, this was the 80s, man. It wasn't that long ago. I guess it was that long ago. And that's what I did. And when I moved to New York, I made $200 a week, which was not much back then. I know a lot of people say, that was a lot of money back then. No, this was not much money back then. And my apartment in Brooklyn cost $600 a month. Do the math. It was a lot of ramen and it was a lot of pizza. But I was really happy. And I'm guessing with your degree, you can get a job better than that. Although it was pretty awesome. I learned New York in about 3 weeks because I was traveling all over the place, all through the streets, going to all the box offices, delivering tickets, delivering, you know, all this mail. I loved it. I had a great time. I wouldn't call it a career, but I really loved it. But I got into that industry. And I rose within 5 years to be a general manager of this giant theater, right? And I was able to be who I was and affect change in my own little way, one person surrounded by a whole lot of hostility. Now imagine if I wasn't alone. Imagine if I had a guy in accounting, and I had a guy in human resources, and I had a woman in the hairdressing department, and I had a couple of actors, and I had this and I had that. Imagine the real difference that you could make if you actually got into an arena other than business, other than law, other than coming to this town, working for a politician, working for a lobbying firm, and becoming one of the pod people. I know it's not what you were probably expecting to hear today. I love Washington. It's a great place to live. It's actually a great place to work. In many ways, it'll kill you. And sadly, believe it or not, in Washington, you can't make nearly the kind of difference in this country than you could make if you got into something that will affect our culture. Because people in Washington, they all see what's on TV, they all see what's in the films, they all see what's on stage, and they react to it. Which brings us back to Hamilton. Hillary Clinton lost the election. Yeah. I believe, mainly because she was in a cultural bubble. For all the same people who don't understand why I am amused and not terrified by President Trump, they don't understand why I am repulsed by Lena Dunham. And that's important, because the people who love Lena Dunham, and by the way, conservatives are allowed to love Lena Dunham, or at least love girls, or love, okay, you're right, we shouldn't. But all of the people who do, they're devoted to her. They think that she can do no wrong. And we don't get that, right? It's like completely foreign to me. 10 years ago, I would have made the exact same point with Rosie O'Donnell. Or I'm trying not to be thinking of famous women who are somewhat overweight. I promise I'm not doing it on purpose. But then they didn't understand 10 years ago why we thought that President George W. Bush was a pretty cool guy and a pretty honorable man. That's okay. We don't get each other. But if you're trying to appeal to the entire nation, when you're giving your speech at the Democratic National Convention, don't end it with a lyric from Hamilton, which is what she did. Don't have a whole lineup of Broadway performers representing a Benetton ad of every race and gender and, are we allowed to say gender anymore? Well, anyway, they were all up there and they were all singing an original song written by Broadway composers. And listen, I love Broadway, but I recognize that it is a very specific and elitist medium right now that is really only written for and designed for one audience, the same people who are creating it. That's not how you open yourselves up. That's not how you can actually get people to say, I'm one of you. You hate that, I'm sorry. It just surprised me. I'm used to a microphone being here. So, Hillary Clinton thought it was a really smart idea, though. That's the key lesson here. There was no one in the room to say, you know, Secretary Clinton, which I think is what they forced her to call her, Secretary Clinton, that's not really accessible to everybody in this country, and it's going to look a little elitist, and it's going to look a little snotty and stuck up. But no, Hillary had seen this show 3 times. And for crying out loud, every night it got a standing ovation. I mean, everyone in her world was talking about it. Well, yes, because everyone in her world was Manhattan and D.C. And you're right. It's sold out. It's the biggest show on Broadway. Well, the Richard Rogers Theater seats about 1,500 people, and they do 8 shows a week. So even if the show runs for 6 months, in the grand scheme of things, that's not a whole lot of people, actually. But in Hillary Clinton's world, it was. That's why The Apprentice beat Hamilton. Think about it. A lot more people saw The Apprentice, and whether they voted for him because he was a TV star or not, there was a sense of familiarity there, and there was also a sense of understanding when he was acting, well, not like your typical person running for president. Because whenever this outlandish thing would happen and Joe Scarborough and Mika Brzezinski's head would explode saying, that's it, this disqualifies him as president. How many times did we hear that, by the way? This disqualifies him for president. The last time I checked, the only thing that disqualifies someone from president is not being 35 years old and not being a natural born U.S. citizen. I got that from the Constitution, by the way. Nothing else. You could be a felon and be the president. In fact, we've had a couple. So, hearing this disqualifies him from president, well, most people would just look at that and say, what's the guy who hosted The Apprentice? What do you want? And then all of the escalation, the basket of deplorables, the, oh my gosh, this is fascism, oh my God, this is Hitler. And then the normal people who don't actually start watching politics until after the conventions, yeah, that's right. I know we like watching it 2 years out, but most normal human beings in the world have lives and families and jobs and children and just want to watch their favorite football team. And by the way, I'm not saying that to demean them, as many people in this town will. I actually say that in admiration for them because I would like to just focus on that. They tuned in, and all they knew was, well, everyone on my Facebook page is saying we're about to nominate Hitler for president. So I better take a look. And they didn't see Hitler, did they? I mean, honestly, when he won the election, all he had to do was not be Hitler. Kind of low bar, right? Or Hillary. Potato, potato. So think about how the pop culture was reflected through this election. I've just laid it out for you. You've got The Apprentice, and you've got really, really smart people who know exactly what you should be thinking, and so they'll tell you what you should think, telling you that this guy is the most dangerous person ever to even think about running for president. How did the Republican Party nominate him? He's Hitler. And you've got this woman who says, I'm going to quote Hamilton. Everyone loves that. And I'm going to have Lena Dunham go up and speak for me at my convention. Who won? Okay? So now, take that lesson for a second and understand what mass media and culture can actually do in our country. And think about where you might want to end up, potentially, to help make that difference. Because honestly, listen, coming to Washington is great. It really is. And getting into politics is great. It is. If you're a sick human being. But if you're a normal human being who wants to have a normal life and actually feel good about yourself at the end of the day, think about something else. Sorry. So, oh, you don't have to get up. I hope you're doing that for everybody. I'm supposed to answer your questions. Oh my God, you guys darted. All right, help me out. So now on my radio show, by the way, I'm not used to talking that long. I usually break every 7 minutes for traffic and weather. This is the equivalent of me taking calls. Now, usually my producer will screen the calls and say, okay, that's great, that's wonderful.